Welcome to the Tuttle and Kline Show.
Systems check. We look good.
Yeah. Yeah. Things are great.
Sound good?
Sounds awesome.
Yes, it does. Oh, the Cannibal Corpse t-shirt Kevin Kline sporting this morning.
North America 2022 tour.
For those of you unaware, Kevin likes those artists where they... And you just wait for the devil to, like, spin up through the floor.
I've seen them 17 times now.
Jeez, man.
And I'm still alive.
That's what you're doing in your retirement is you become like a follower of certain artists, haven't you?
Yeah, I go to quite a few concerts, but I always did, you know, because we were in music for a long, long time. And I love concerts. I love live music. So when COVID hit, man, that was one of the worst because, you know, all the concert venues shut down.
Yeah, no, man, that was terrible.
Who have you seen the most times?
I would say Kiss.
That's a band I never saw.
You never saw Kiss?
Never live. Nope.
Okay, Kev, everybody with pyrotechnics and over the top shows, they've all copied Kiss.
I mean, even Garth Brooks says that he copied Kiss.
He admitted it. I'm Kiss with a cowboy hat.
Yeah.
That's what he said.
Yeah. So I was a member of the Kiss Army. Were you a member of the Kiss Army?
1978, when I was 9 years old, I became a member. I remember getting my card in the mail.
Yeah, man.
I was so proud of it. My dad took me to a show and freaked out when Gene Simmons was spitting blood.
Your dad took you to a concert? My dad took me to my first.
Did he really?
Yeah. Yeah. Def Leppard, Pyromania.
Oh, that's awesome. 1983 or 84?
It was probably 84 or 8. Yeah. Well, maybe 84, 85, something like that, because I was a freshman or a sophomore in high school. So,
yeah.
Yeah. We should start our own Tuttle and Kline Army.
Tuttle and Kline Army?
Yeah.
I like that.
Like the Kiss Army, you know?
Yeah, like the Tuttle and Kline Army. We may not have the numbers they do, but, I mean, you only need about 11 to take over a country.
They only started with one, remember?
Exactly. And yeah. By the way, speaking of which, the Tuttle and Kline Army, thank you all so much for the support.
I mean, oh, yeah, it's been phenomenal.
It's amazing. The comments, the feedback. We would just ask, continue to tell friends about us. We really want to grow this into something fun, and we appreciate each and every one of you. Kev,
tell your enemies.
Yeah, tell your enemies.
Yeah.
You know, there's no better way to get them back.
That's right. Yeah. Why not?
And then expose them to this crap for an hour and a half a week.
There you go. Yeah.
Kev, I got a DM from last week's show.
Oh, that's a direct message.
That's correct.
Okay.
I got a DM. It was from Rob in Pennsylvania.
Hey, Rob.
And I'm not sure the exact origin story of where we get listeners from Pennsylvania, but we got them from all over the place. It's kind of freaky. We got them overseas in Germany and Ireland and India and crap like that.
I know. And they're not even trying to hack us.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for not hacking us.
That's right.
He asks, hey, I hear you guys say this all the time, and I see you posting it all the time. You say Houston is the greatest city on earth. How do you really know that? He asks.
And it's a good point.
I got to thinking, you know, because he may be right. I mean, who can even judge? Has there been anybody ever that's been to every single city?
City, no, but I do know somebody who's been to every country.
Really?
Yes.
Well, what do they say is the best country?
I never really quite asked them that question. I know for me, and I'm not saying that it's a better city than Houston. I think for me, Paris is my favorite city I've ever
Paris
been in.
Paris is.
Oh my God, dude.
Weren't they snooty to you because you're an American?
No, they weren't. Not at all.
Or do you do what a lot of Americans do when they travel abroad? They say they're Canadian.
No.
Just to avoid the heat.
No, I learned basic phrases and you just try and just learn basic phrases. Hello, thank you, please, that kind of stuff. To me, there's no prettier language in the world than French, followed very closely by Italian, which if you wouldn't mind, Timmy, we'd love to hear some Italian right now because you're fluent.
Okay, I'm fluent in Italian. Hey, Kevin, what's going on? I cannot wait. I hear.
He's so fluent.
Yeah, very fluent. And you should see it when I actually talk to Italians. They love it too.
But you know what's crazy, Tim, is when you go to like Massachusetts and you see buildings that are like 225 years old, and then you go to France or you go to Italy and you see 2,000 year old buildings.
Isn't that crazy?
Oh my gosh, dude. It's very humbling.
Yeah. Anyway, you know, bring it back around to Rob in Pennsylvania. You're right. I mean, we haven't been to every city. I just think Houston's the best for personal reasons. They've been kind to my family. They've been good to us. It's a nice, diversified melting pot with all kinds of different cultures. On some days I want some, you know, I want some Indian food. I can go, you know, right there, and I can go to Chinatown. You know, it's really cool that way. But yeah, you're right. I mean, there could be like a remote city in the middle of nowhere. It's got 147 different people in it. 145 of them are gorgeous ladies that'll service you for a nickel.
Wow.
The other two are guys that'll talk sports and hand you nickels.
Hand you nickels. Nice.
There could be a city like that somewhere.
Yeah, there could be. There could be.
And if you ever find it.
Yes. DM us.
DM us, please. I love our good friends at Air Innovations. They're so proud to be part of our podcast, Kev. We're getting back that they liked the fact that we saluted the technicians who have to go in to hardcore places in the middle of like heavy heat and get people up and going. You know, there's no parades for them. There's no songs written about them, but they're really, really good people. And Air Innovations, I love their story, Kevin. This is Troy and Kelly. They're from the Cypress area. As a matter of fact, that's where home office is, but they serve the entire Houston metro area. You know, they went to school at Cypress ISD, and they got out of school in 2005. They decided they're going to start the Air Innovations, and it's just become a monster taking care of everybody in Houston. And I love their attitude. They support the community with blood drives, and they're really a good, caring company. I'm so proud that they're part of the Tuttle and Kline podcast family.
You know, it kind of goes back to what Rob was asking. How do we know that Houston's such a great city? Air Innovations is the perfect example. Houstonians helping Houstonians. You know, they could have taken their business anywhere, but they kept it right here in Houston. And we love that about them. You know, we mentioned last week, Tim, that the technicians, doesn't Air Innovations kind of talk about in our proponents of doing pre-season maintenance? Because you guys are about ready to get hit with the heat.
Yeah, the heat's coming. And I know a lot of people have an AC unit, Kev, that after like, you know, August or early September, when it finally started to, you know, let up a little bit, their AC unit was going.
Exactly. It was on.
Yeah.
Like an 80 year old in a nursing home.
Yes, exactly. And you're thinking, you know, okay, we made it, but now it's hanging over you. It's looming over you like a big cloud going, ooh, you know, we just had some 80 degree temperatures the last couple of days. Just reach out to Air Innovations. They're fair, good people. They'll come do a check on it. It's always good to have the preventative maintenance so you don't get the big one at the wrong time in the middle of July, if you know what I'm talking about. So,
know exactly what you're talking about.
If you want to reach out to them, I got the phone number right there in the right-hand corner. And we also have a link to their website in the description, available in the description. So just go click on it and get taken care of by Air Innovations. Kevin Kline, I'm so intrigued. I love doing these. I was excited when you sent me a message saying that you want one of your dreams analyzed.
Oh, this is crazy. Okay. So the other day I had this dream, and I dreamt that Trish and I, my wife, we were in my bedroom that I grew up in. All right.
Your bedroom
The room that I shared with my brother. We had two, I had a single bed and he had a single bed. Well, she wakes me up and I noticed that there is a massive boa constrictor slithering on top of the dresser. So I'm like, did you see that snake over there? And she's like, yeah, hold on a second. She goes and she grabs it behind the head and she takes it out to the front porch. Our front porch didn't do this in real life, but in the dream, it backed up to a swamp and she lets it go. And I'm like, you can't let it go right there. It's just going to slither back into the house. Well, She goes and tracks it, and it tracks over to the neighbor's yard, and it's no longer in the form of a snake. It's still a snake, but it's now in the form of a dog. And
what?
The dog, it's not walking like a dog. It's slithering like a dog, and it slithers up to my neighbor's porch and just sits at the door, just stands at the door, and she goes over and she goes, come on, get out here, get out here. And it comes over and she starts petting it on the head. The hell does that mean?
I would say that means you need to stop eating Thai food so close to going to bed.
Right? Yeah, well, I looked up a dream analyzation of this.
Oh, did you? What did this say?
So you type into Google, it says, what does a dream about a snake and dog pops up immediately? So it's like, I'm not the only one that has this, okay? So
okay.
A snake in a dream apparently is a good thing because the snake signifies that a transformation is coming, whether it's exterior or internal, doesn't decipher that, but a transformation is coming. And then a dog always is loyalty and companionship. So now that you know that, interpret what change is coming and where's my loyalty?
I don't know. I think the change probably could be maybe a sports team that you used to like and you're not like them anymore, but you've been looking over and going, ooh, you know, that Dolphins uniform looks a lot like the Tuttle and Kline colors, you know, from their logo, from our logo. And I don't know.
Isn't it crazy though?
Mm-hmm.
I always thought a snake was a bad thing in a dream, but no, a snake's a pretty good thing.
I didn't know that either. I'm so surprised that you're able to have like that vivid of a dream. And it seemed like it was running a long time. I mean, it seemed like to be a Scorsese tracking shot that lasted a long time. I never get those. I never get those. First off, I rarely even remember a dream. Maybe once every like 3 or 4 months, I'll remember something that I dreamed.
Really?
Yeah. Once every 3 or 4 months. What does that mean?
That
I can't remember dreams. I mean, obviously every single time, every human, tell me if I'm wrong, when you go into deep REM, when you go to sleep, you're dreaming about something.
Yeah.
Cause the mind doesn't go completely black, but here I am, somebody that once every 120 days may remember just a little snapshot glimpse of a dream.
That is odd.
What does that mean?
Well, it means that one dream is very, prominent. It's a very prominent dream if that's the one you're remembering, and maybe all the other ones are superfluous in your life. I don't know. If you ever dream in neon colors, that means that you're predicting your future. I had a psychic tell me that once. Yeah. So
really.
Uh huh. And you know, you were just talking about the length of dreams. Dreams are like an instant. Yeah, it sounds like a Scorsese movie, but that happens in like a second.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's the last dream I remember. Maybe you can interpret this real quick.
Okie dokie.
Last dream, I was cliff diving.
Okay.
And I started to like do a backflip when I jumped off the cliff.
Uh-huh.
And this one time a big gust of wind came and I hit my head on the cliff. And then I started to see the future.
Okay. Oh, that's easy. That's easy.
What do you got there? What do you got there, Clark?
The cliff represents me, and you're trying to jump away from it. But every time you try and get away, I somehow pull you back in, and you hit your head on me. And then all of a sudden, you're like, man, where do I go now? And so that's the wind trying to carry you away, but it doesn't know where it's taking you. There you go.
I like it. I'm going to go with it. I can't get away from you.
No, you can't. No. Uh-uh. I won't let you.
You're like luggage and herpes. It's just there forever.
There forever.
Yeah. Kevin is herpes. That's what he is.
There's no cure.
Got another DM, by the way, from a listener.
We love them.
Do you remember, this was from Krista in Pasadena, Texas. And do you remember last week we were talking about, you know, if I had a time machine, I would go back and talk to the 17-year-old me and tell him, you know, hey, you know, this is how you should handle beautiful women. You have a thing for beautiful women and you're able to get them, but you don't know how to handle it. And I would try to walk him through some instruction.
Mm-hmm. I remember that.
Well, Krista basically said, that is a wasted opportunity, Timmy T. You need to tell the 17-year-old self the Back to the Future thing too. the gambling.
Oh, okay.
So she's totally right.
Yeah. Yeah.
That is a wasted opportunity.
Yeah. Like, you know, this team's going to win the Super Bowl. So yeah. bet.
I would go back to the 17-year-old me and I wouldn't say anything but this. All right, Timmy, as you can see, it's a bigger, stronger version of you from the future, 2024. So listen to me or I'll whoop your ass because, you know, I'm older.
That's right.
But you're much skinnier. So I will whoop your ass. Okay. Move to Vegas with your graduation money and every penny that you have. You're going to bet on the Giants to win the Super Bowl, Indiana to win the NCAA championship, the Lakers to win the NBA title. Are you writing this down, ADD boy? Okay. Twins win the World Series. Next year, listen to me closely, Redskins, Kansas Jayhawk, Lakers again. Yeah, I know they're annoying. I hate the Lakers too. We both hate the Lakers. Oh, imagine that. We both hate the Lakers. But your god, Michael Jordan, he's going to win it in 91, 92, 93, 96, 97, 98. So you're cool. All right.
Just think you could buy the farm back that your grandfather lost.
Through betting.
Full circle.
Oh, yeah. 17-year-old Timmy, I see you still have your OJ poster up. I got some bad news for you.
Yep.
Sit down. Oh, yeah. And by the way, Timmy, quit hiding your weed up in that ceiling tile right there. Mom eventually finds it.
And it's eventually legal. Right?
Yeah. It's eventually legal. Yes. Yeah. You are Krista from Pasadena. You are totally correct. The conclusion is it's tougher for these beautiful women to leave a billionaire than it is a guy living in a 675 square foot apartment.
Okay. All alone. But let me ask you this though. Do you really want somebody who's just there for the cash? Okay.
Yeah. I'm cool. I'm good.
Yeah, I'm cool. All right.
Kev, that's my whole problem is, have you ever seen the absolute gorgeous women that, you know, that
yes.
flock towards that? Yeah, they're shallow for the most part. And they can't spell cat if you spot on the C and the A.
Oh, geez. But yeah, they're very attractive ladies. Yes.
I know. I got that. That's the number one thing. Trust me. I know there's a lot of people rolling their eyes right now, listening or watching this. I'm working on that. Okay. I'm working on that.
Don't you wish you had that shallow Hal skill where you could see past and see the inside? You know, if you've never seen the movie, it's a really good movie. It's talking about inner beauty as opposed to exterior.
That's like, who'd want to see their like guts and their.
No. It's the soul. You're seeing the person's soul. Okay. Yeah. You're not seeing the spleen.
No entrails or anything.
No.
Okay.
Yeah. See what you had for dinner.
I just. Kev, you know what this leads me to, this time machine stuff?
Please tell me.
It leads me to this week's top three.
Just when you thought they couldn't count any higher, it's Tuttle and Kline's top three.
Should I be nervous?
I think you're gonna love this.
Okay.
Kevin, I need from you the top three historical events you would jump into your time machine with a bag of popcorn and watch.
Oh my. That is a tough one.
Historical events.
Watch live, right?
Yeah, you're able to go, like, you're able to like land your time machine, hop out of it. You got a lawn chair. They give you a lawn chair and a bucket of popcorn.
Okay.
And you could just sit there and you could watch, and you're not going to be seen. You're not going to be part of it. Uh-huh. You just get to watch it.
Hindenburg.
It bursts into flames. Get it started. It's rising. Terrible. Oh, my. Get out of the way, please. It's burning, bursting into flames, and it's falling on the morning fast and all the folks between it. This is terrible. This is one of the worst catastrophes in the world. And the flame is rising to the ground, not quite to the mooring mast. Oh, the humanity.
Dude, I had that on my honorable mention list.
Really?
That's so funny. Oh, the humanity.
Yeah, one of the greatest calls in reporting ever, this blimp ignites and catches on fire and plummets to the ground. There's footage out there of it, but I mean, if you're talking about live, the visual of that would have been just amazing.
Yeah. Okay, that's a good one. That's kind of weird that you and I were on the same, because there's, I don't know if you knew this or not, there are billions of historical events.
Yes.
And you and I locked in on the same one. I can't wait to hear your next one.
Yeah, well, the next one's going to be, wow, Klein's hell-bent on destruction, the atomic bomb test. And maybe it's just because I've seen Oppenheimer 3 times, but to be there for the test and experience and the feeling of that rush coming past you in the noise, yeah. I don't know.
And Kev, don't apologize for, you know, you liking the mayhem. I mean, it's a total dude thing.
Yeah.
Especially dudes wearing black t-shirts saying Cannibal Corpse.
Very true, right?
And then the obviously
third,
we know.
And then the third one, I would have given anything to be in the arena when the Miracle on Ice happened.
Morrow is back there. Now Johnson, 19 seconds. Johnson over to Ramsey. The Legionov gets checked by Ramsey. McClanahan is there. The puck is still loose. 11 seconds. You've got 10 seconds. The countdown going on right now. Morrow up to Schultz. 5 seconds left in the game. Do you believe in miracles? Yes!
Unbelievable. That would have been cool. Miracle on Ice, of course. We've talked about this before. The U.S. men's hockey team in 1980. They're college kids. These guys are 21 to like 24 years old, beating the Russians, who are basically the best pro all-star team in history. These guys are averaging about 32 years old, been together, some of them for 15 years. There was no way that it's the greatest upset, underdog upset in the history of sports, period.
Even bigger than Rocky.
Even bigger than Rocky, even bigger than Buster Douglas against Tyson, even bigger than North Carolina State versus our own Phi Slamma Jamma Houston Cougars with Akeem Olajuwon, Clyde Drexler, Michael Young, Benny Anders, and all those guys. Even a bigger upset than that, times two, like all of those woven together.
Yeah, the electricity in that building must have been amazing. So I would say those three.
When they scored the last goal to take the lead, the U.S. team, and it was with exactly 10 minutes left.
Yeah.
And just that frantic 10 minutes, each second ticking off the clock, and you're just in the stands going, oh, God, please. And I'll tell you, the Russians or the Soviet Union, they were going crazy to try to score. I mean, they knew that they were in the deepest trouble they have ever been in as a team, and they were frantic, and they were desperate, and they were flipping them by, and Jim Craig was just knocking everything out of the way, our goalie for the U.S.
There's a great movie. It's called Miracle. It was it's actually a Disney movie. Disney produced it. It's an amazing story, and it talks about the Miracle on Ice and how in that game, Russia had never been tested before. And so they get 10 minutes left in the game and they're behind. They didn't know how to react.
Yeah, they didn't understand. They're usually up 10-3.
Yeah.
Or 10-2. You know? And so they didn't get it. And you could see their eyes were widening and the coach's eyes widening. You know, the guy with the big brushy eyebrows.
Yeah.
Whoever the Soviet coach was, I mean, he's freaking out, looking over, going, we have never, you know what I'm saying?
I know exactly what you're saying. It's one of my favorite movies. Check it out.
I love it. It's awesome. I mean, Kev, when that happened, you were still 10 years old and I was 11 years old. And did you know, I lived in Wisconsin. So the word got around about the gold medal because it was we watched a tape delay on TV. They did not play it live. Isn't that crazy? They did not play that game live. We watched it on a tape delay. And even during the hockey game, Kev, they were cutting away to, like, you know, ice dancing. And they were cutting away to, you know, slalom or whatever, you know. And you're just like, no, take us.
Yeah. Put us in the arena.
Put us in the arena. You know, even with the under 10 minutes left when we had the lead. Okay, and now we're going to go see what's going on out here at speed skating with Eric Heiden. Who cares about freaking Eric Heiden right now?
Yeah, and it was one of the greatest calls in all of sports. Do you believe in miracles? It was Al Michaels, and that's where the word miracle comes from. It was from Al Michaels' call.
Did he trademark that and ever make any money off of that?
I don't think he ever trademarked it. No, No. No, I don't think so.
Because I'm thinking of trademarking Percy.
Well, you should.
I'm just kidding.
No, you know, it's interesting because Trish, my wife, our intern, has done research into how we trademark our logo and how we copyright stuff It's actually a lengthy process. I was thinking about doing it for the fuzzy mic, but when I saw how many steps it is, I'm like,
yeah, I don't think that anything that I do is so creative and mind freaking blowing that I need to spend 3 hours doing paperwork. I just don't think. Yeah.
Yeah. And unless you have, let's get ready to rumble and you make $5,000 every time somebody steals that.
Is that what Michael Buffer makes off of that?
Oh dude, he makes bank. He makes bank off of that.
Wait a minute. So if you want, I mean, do we have to pay right now? Cause you just said it.
No, I'm not using it for commercial purposes.
I was going to say that. I mean, we're still a fledgling podcast. That would break us right there, Kev.
It would. You're right. No, but I'm not using it for commercial purposes.
But by the way, if you are watching this and, you know, we got a great audience. We're top 10% worldwide already. We would love for you to be a sponsor because you never know when Kevin Kline is going to upset Michael Buffer and Buffer wants a check.
That's right.
Okay. Yeah. So just leave a comment or a DM or something like that. And, well, one of us will get back to you in regards to how to sponsor the Tuttle and Kline podcast. Kev, my top three historical events that I would jump into a time machine with a bag of popcorn and a lawn chair and watch.
Can I guess your first?
Sure.
JFK.
No.
No. Really?
No.
Oh, because you would want it. You would be compelled to jump in and tackle the person.
Yeah, I would. I would interfere. I only unless I can intervene in the grassy knoll where the guy dressed as a cop and his handler had fired the fatal shot. Only if I can intervene on that shot.
Okay. But that's not what this is about.
I couldn't sit there and watch it. It would drive me crazy. It would make it crazy.
Yeah.
It would. It would make me crazy.
Okay. So JFK is not on the list.
No. And, you know, I was thinking, you know, stuff like Normandy, D-Day, June 6, 1944, World War II. But, you know, we there's footage of that. And we saw that in Private Ryan, Saving Private Ryan.
Yeah.
And they say that Spielberg captured that in such a way that World War II vets said there is no more accurate version of any kind of wartime situation than that scene right there. And as a matter of fact, a lot of WW2 veterans back in 97 when it came out, they couldn't even watch it.
Exactly right. Yep.
They couldn't even watch it because it was so like right on the money. So and I was also thinking stuff like, you know, the Hindenburg was on my list, but I have that as an honorable mention because, you know, there's film of it.
Sure.
And I'm very intrigued by when Pete Rose broke Ty Cobb's hit record. I'm very intrigued by that.
Everybody on their feet here in Cincinnati and a worldwide television audience watching these moments tonight here at Riverfront Stadium. 2-1 pitch from Shaw.
But, you know, again, there's footage of it. I could just watch it. I want to go to, like, something not filmed.
Good point.
You know?
Such as?
Yeah, like a battle like Valley Forge.
Oh.
In the Revolutionary War, Gettysburg and the Civil War, and just sit there and, you know, just kind of intrigued on how war was fought back then. Because, you know, we have our vision of it now.
Yeah.
It looks like Star Wars. I'm just wondering what it's like when... You know, when the Brits just line up in one row and, you know, all we had to do here, like the American colonists, just pick them off one at a time.
Yeah.
You know,
would you commentate, though? I mean, you would have to commentate, right?
Oh, look at there. Paul Revere gets a shot off. Look out. Poor Nelly. Look at that. Look at the British redcoat and the way that brain opened up.
Holy crap. Oh, wow.
Too graphic for you?
No.
I hate tyranny, Kev.
I know you do.
Tyranny. And
I
know. When they push too far and the time has come to kill them, we have to kill them. You understand, right?
T-I-M-T-U-T-T-L-E.
They know.
They know.
Trust me, they know. I'm on every list.
All right. So early skirmishes.
Yeah. I've become very intrigued because I found out my sister, Tina, has done unbelievable genetic family tree research.
Mm-hmm.
And I found out that, you know, I am a direct descendant of Aaron Burr, the Vice President of the United States for Thomas Jefferson.
Yeah.
Also, he is one of the founding fathers, Aaron Burr is.
Mm-hmm.
And he's also probably most well known for the duel he had with Hamilton.
Yeah.
In which he killed Hamilton. So yep. My great, you know, do it like 13 times, killed Hamilton.
And that's probably where your patriotism comes from. He being one of the founding.
Give me liberty or give me death, baby.
Yeah.
I regret that I only have one life to live for my great country, the United States of America. Anyway, I wouldn't mind watching the duel.
Okay.
All just right. Watching the, I mean, because he put the shot. I mean, Tuttles are well known for our aim. We can hit, you know, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's why you have four kids.
I don't know if that's aim. I think that's lack of pullout game.
Lack of, okay.
Okay, and then I would probably, Kev, I would watch Lincoln in the theater box.
Oh, okay.
Probably have to watch that because there's no footage of that.
No footage of that one either.
And I heard that his head actually went back into the left, that there may have been somebody in front row stage left that might have fired the fatals. I'm just kidding.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, really? That's a conspiracy too?
No.
See, I thought we knew that one.
That's what they try to do is they try to mix in like wacky, crazy conspiracies to make all conspiracy quote unquote theorists sound crazy.
Yeah. Well, remember, everybody at one time thought the National Enquirer was full of hooey, and everything that the Enquirer ended up printing ended up in the long run coming out to be true.
They were just
ahead of everybody.
Basically, it's like this. When you hear conspiracy theory, that's what they don't want you to know that's the truth that's going to come out later. Whenever you hear it, that's a good little guideline for you to live by. So yeah, I am, those are mine. I want to see stuff, Kev, that there's no footage of.
Yeah. I got that from your list.
Like, you know, how delicious looking was that apple with Adam and Eve?
Oh yeah. Metaphor, but you know, I get what you're saying.
You know what I'm talking about.
Oh yeah. I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
Okay. You know, stuff like that.
Right.
Does that change, you know, Kev, give me real quick, you know, stuff that wasn't filmed. I mean, wouldn't it have been cool to watch like the last day of construction of the pyramid in Egypt?
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, I actually would have liked to watch the first day. What do you mean we're going to do what? You got to be out of your fucking mind.
Hold on. Just us right here.
Yeah.
And you're going to build it that big and it has to be No.
Yeah.
No. You can go ahead and whip me all you want. I don't care.
That's right.
I ain't picking. Okay. All right. That hurts. We'll get started.
Yep.
We'll get started. Where do you want to build it? Good one.
Thanks. Now, you know what? I'm pretty set in mind, even though I know mine, because I just want to be there to experience the things you can't get on film, you know, the atmosphere.
I get it.
Yeah. Yeah. So
I get it.
I wouldn't change it.
I get it. Okay. Like, so you would like in 86 when the Challenger blew up.
Engine's throttling up. Three engines now at 104%.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Minute 15 seconds. Velocity 2,900 feet per second. Altitude 9 nautical miles. Downrange distance 7 nautical miles.
Just to see the reaction from people on the ground watching it go in. Because that was a big one. That was a big launch because it had the teacher on it.
Yeah. Krista McAuliffe.
That's it. Krista McAuliffe. Yeah. So that's a huge crowd. And, you know, nothing like that has ever happened. I mean, we had Apollo 13 that happened 14 years or so before it, but that was when they were coming back and they ended up surviving.
Mm-hmm.
Just to sit there and like, what? Oh my God. You know,
well, didn't they, during one of the Apollos, they did have a blow up on the launch pad. And that set it back.
The fire.
But this was the only one that was already.
Yeah. We lost Gus Grissom.
Yeah.
In the fire because they couldn't get out.
Yeah. Yeah.
That happened a couple of years before Apollo 13.
You've been to a launch, haven't you?
I have. I actually watched the John Glenn.
That's right.
When he was 69 years old, this was back in the late 90s, I think 97 or 98, I was offshore because I was doing a morning radio show in Daytona Beach, Florida.
Mm-hmm.
And I was offshore, and they just like they went right over our heads.
Yeah.
Of course, I didn't watch much of it because Audrey and Jonas's mom was throwing up. She was seasick.
Oh.
So
oh, wow. Not
she
fun.
Was, yeah, she got seasick, and I have not, Kev. It doesn't bother me that she ruined the whole fucking thing for me. I've gotten over it. I've gotten past
it. Yes, you have. Yeah, all right. Yeah, I can tell. I can tell totally.
You see, the funny thing is, Kev, is we were there with people that grew up on the water in Daytona Beach or wherever. And they were used to it, and they're just like, we just moved here a few months ago from a place way away from the water, and yeah, she's not feeling good. She's turning different colors right now, and they're just rolling their eyes going, what the hell, man?
Yeah, well, it happens. You know, it happens. So, I mean, she used to get car sick, too.
Yeah, I know. And that's the thing. Kev, I don't want to belabor anything.
Uh-huh.
I mean, if you're somebody that gets car sick all the time, you know.
He's over it.
Maybe you should sit this one out.
Wow.
I mean, it's right on TV. This is John Glenn going up into space again, his 69-year-old senator.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's all over TV, or, you know. Or, hey, they got this motion sickening, these pills. And you've taken these pills a lot before. And suddenly today, of all he's days.
Completely over it.
You decide you're not going to take the pills. It's cool.
Yeah.
Totally cool.
Totally cool. Not a historic site at all.
Kev, we have another sponsor, Home Video Rescue.
Very excited about this.
This is an exciting situation for us because Chris, the proprietor of Home Video Rescue, has a service that I know a lot of us have thought about before. He has the ability, and we have a link, by the way, in the description here. You could just click on it, and he goes through step by step of what needs to be done. If you have VHS, 8mm, if you have DVDs, all kinds of different older mediums, and you want to turn it into digital, your family memories, your sports heroics into digital, so it'll last forever. I mean, a lot of people have those precious memories, mm-hmm. Kev.
Yeah.
And they're not. It's not going to survive forever.
No.
Each day that passes, the quality and the the tape that it's on and the medium that it's on is reduced.
Well, and also think about it from this aspect, okay? When do you like to show those memories? Pretty much when you're together with family or friends, loved ones, right? Imagine taking a sack of VHS tapes over to grandma's house for Thanksgiving as opposed to a little USB card that's got everything on it.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
Exactly.
I love the convenience of that.
I love it too. Home Video Rescue offers that service for you. They'll take really, really good care of you, and they take their time on it. I like Chris is very meticulous on, he knows that this is more valuable than gold.
Mm-hmm.
This is the value of this is priceless because it's your memories. It's your growing up. It's your Kev.
Yeah.
I cannot wait to find there's VHS tapes. Somewhere, I think my mom has them somewhere, of me dunking the basketball.
Oh, wow. In high school, yeah.
Yeah, and you know, I know it doesn't seem like it by looking at me, but I used to have some ups.
Yeah.
I used to fly. Used to get the almost elbow over the rim, and I would walk the dog, but I couldn't rock the cradle like MJ.
Yeah.
And have some pretty nasty dunks.
And that's on that VHS tape.
On those tapes, man.
You got to get
those home runs that I hit over the wall.
Yeah.
You know, those are there. And I cannot wait. As soon as I get a hold of those VHS tapes, I'm going to hop it. I'm going to make it happen.
Yeah, because they're collecting dust right now. They're collecting dust and they're deteriorating every single day that goes by. Think about how convenient it would be to have it on a USB card and then you could upload it and send it out to whoever you want.
Right.
I love that concept.
And the thing I love about Chris is he doesn't ask questions either.
So okay.
If you have some of those intimate moments,
yeah,
you know, back when you two were young and in your 20s, he doesn't He doesn't peruse it. He doesn't preview it. He just rolls it.
Kim Kardashian and Ray J. He can do it. He can do it.
And he's one of those guys that, you know, he's not going to always not. Yeah. He'll respect your memories.
Yeah.
Okay. So it is home video rescue. We have the link in the description. Click on it and then make your memories last forever.
Love it.
I didn't even know. Is that his tagline? Because that sounds like a cool tagline, does it?
It's a great tagline. And if it's not, Chris, you can go ahead and use that.
I'll give it to you for free because you're one of the ground floor sponsors. Ground floor sponsors of the Tuttle and Kline podcast. And we appreciate the heck out of you. Kev, I have to know what's going on here. You're getting messaged or DM'd or something like that from a former Playboy playmate.
Not just a playmate, a PMOY.
That's Playmate of the Year.
That's right, buddy. Yep. I got a LinkedIn Connect request from Karen McDougal.
I remember her.
Yeah. Well, who doesn't? She was involved with the Trump scandal. Yeah. But Karen McDougal was a Playmate of the Year. And I got to connect. I think she thinks I'm my uncle, you know, but then I'm thinking, you know, what could she possibly need with him? You know, so I reached back out to her. I'm waiting to hear back.
Okay. All right. So Karen McDougal.
Yeah.
Do you have a picture that you could post right here?
Yeah, there she is right there. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Is hopping into Kevin Kline's DM. I'm impressed. Hopping in your DMs.
Yeah. Well, if she messages me back and we get the real reason, I'm sure it will be very unimpressive.
What? Kev, don't sell yourself short, okay? You're a tremendous slouch. Caddyshack.
And I'm no slouch myself.
Don't sell yourself short, Judge. You're a tremendous slouch.
Yeah, yeah.
Anytime we could do a Caddyshack reference.
The only thing I can think of is one of her fellow playmates is now a licensed therapist. And so I've been messaging her to try and get her on the Fuzzy Mic to talk about self-empowerment. Maybe she reached out to Karen. I don't know. But
yeah, maybe she's just like, hey, yeah. I got a thing for geeky looking Harry Potter dudes.
Yeah.
Who are just, you're just so awkward and are just so nerdy and weird that it's kind of a turn on.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it's like who was the Shannon in the American Pie movies when she went after the Shermanator?
I get it, okay? You know? Maybe I am a geek. Whatever.
Yes. Yes, you are.
Exactly. She went after the Shermanator.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. So you never know, Kev. It could be that. And if I'm Mrs. Kline, you know, I may be looking over my shoulder if I'm her.
Nah. Nothing to worry about. Nothing to worry about.
She'd be like, take him.
Yeah. Well, not only that, but as I would emphatically say, as beautiful as Karen McDougal is, that's how beautiful my wife is on the inside. So I ain't going nowhere.
Oh, you just, Kev, I just heard like thousands and thousands of collective. Oh,
yeah. Yeah. It's a sickness. I can't breathe without her. So it's all good.
Oh man. I can't breathe without that's a song. That's a song.
Is it?
I can't breathe without you. I think we could just write a song. I can't breathe without you.
Okay. Well, there we go. We just wrote a song and we'll copyright it. And we'll make lots of money off of it.
If I ever said that to one of the beautiful women I'm dating, she'd be like, good. I hope you die.
That would not be the case. Yeah, you say that to one of your lady friends and dude, they're either going to A, run away and go, dude, this guy's way too serious. Or B, that's the most sweetest thing I've ever heard. Maybe this guy's in it for the long haul.
Yeah, I could just see it. Some lady going, you know, if I just didn't meet you in the produce section right now and you saying that would be very, very touching. Right. But I literally met you 14 seconds ago. Hi, Tim. Nice to meet you. Hey, I can't breathe without you, by the way. You could see him reaching for the mace. Security. Kev, I want to thank you for something. Because you're letting me do this. And hey, seriously, Kev. You, anytime it becomes too much, you just need to tell me. Say, hey, man, I can't do it anymore. Where, you know, for those of you unaware, I'm kind of making a comeback. I was doing some open mic stand-up.
Don't call it a comeback.
Don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years.
Yeah. I was doing some open mics in Houston places back in 2019 for stand-up comedy. And I got the itch when I got the whole itch, you know, to get back on the air and do something creative. And Kevin has been gracious enough to allow me to run material past him for this podcast. And I just need you to tell me, just say, hey, man, it's too much.
No, go ahead.
Are you sure?
Yeah, it ain't too much.
And by the way, I sent this weekend, I emailed Kev, you know, my top five. If you put a gun to my head right now, this would be my tight five that I would do at an open mic. And he helped me adjust some things. Those are good adjustments.
Oh, you liked them?
I do.
Oh, cool.
I'm just not 100% on it yet. I think it's good, but I Kev, you know me. I need great.
Yeah, absolutely. Which is why it's even more amazing that we've been together for 25 plus years. I mean, I'm the definition of mediocre.
Kevin, I hate to say this to you, but since you bought it, I mean, Caitlin Maida was pretty good.
Yeah, I didn't get to work with her as much as you did, but you know, hey, your word for it.
She actually was solid.
Good.
Like if this thing ever blew up and we became a lot, we'd probably steal her from terrestrial radio. Yeah, we would. And we'd just do like 2 hours, like a couple times a week and make $20 million. That's the goal, by the way.
Oh, I'm very excited to hear you say that. That's cool.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you very much. I do have, now this is freshly written.
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah, because I was going to say, if I already read what you're about to deliver,
it would
fall a little flat.
No.
Okay,
this is, and by the way, in terms of presenting it to you, like when we do this on the podcast, is there a different way I can do it? Should I be doing it like small pieces at a time and pause? Or do you like the way I've been doing it?
Yeah, just do it the way I'm the audience.
Okay. Yeah. All right. I just put this together last week.
All right.
Based on, you know, like kind of a something I saw that's going a little bit viral. They're saying again, Jesus was probably married. Jesus probably had a wife.
Okay.
And I know, you know, every 10 or 15 years or so we hear that.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it got me, I mean, it spurred something. I was doing some cardio and it spurred something that made me chuckle to myself.
All right.
So I decided to flesh it out a little bit.
Sure. Yeah. Good.
And now I want to know what you think of this.
Jesus was married.
Yeah. All right. We got another report just came out saying Jesus was probably married. And now there's even a Wikipedia page about it. So, you know, it's got to be true.
Oh, totally. Yeah. Right.
I'm no historian and I have absolutely no proof whatsoever, but I'm going to tell you this without a shadow of doubt, Jesus Christ had no wife.
Had no wife.
Or if he did, it was the shortest marriage in history.
Why so?
What woman is going to buy his stories, much less put up with his stories? So let me get this straight. You were out fishing with your friends and you walked on water.
Uh-huh.
And you were able to do this because, and these are your words, not my words, you are the Son of God.
Yes.
And then you were at this revival thing and it lasted all day and all night, yet again. And this huge crowd of people needed food and all you had were a couple fish and a couple of loaves and you fed thousands of people.
I love it.
Next thing you tell me, Jesus, is you raised somebody from the dead.
Yeah. Very, very good stuff. That's good on many levels.
Then after the big weekend, when he comes home on Sunday, you and your 12 unemployed loser friends take off on Friday night. I don't hear from you for 3 days. Jesus, you are better off dead than coming home to me right now and telling me this cockamamie story.
Cockamamie. Great word.
Funny you should say that, dear.
Yeah, very good. It's
is
great.
Decent chunk?
Yeah, that's a really good. That's really good. Number one, it's great material. Number two, what makes it even funnier is you doing the voice. Number three, what makes it more relatable is what guy hasn't gone through that before? You know, what married guy hasn't? You know,
exactly.
So yeah, so people can relate to it, and the ladies will cringe at the voice, you know, and stuff, but they'll laugh because they know it's true.
Well, and tell me this, and I tried to write it where I didn't have so much of the lady's voice.
Uh-huh.
But, it, I mean, is the lady's voice too much? Because, I mean, I'm basically hopping off setup and punch, setup, punch, setup, punch, setup, punch, all with the lady's voice. Is that too much?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. I mean, how else would you do it, though? How else would you do it?
I, Kevin, that's the thing. I was trying to figure out a way to have more back and forth, like Jesus, like responding in his calm, laid back Jesus voice.
Yeah.
But it was, you know.
But if you do that, it drags the bit out.
Exactly.
And then you lose people.
Exactly. I mean, I'm to the way I wrote this, I mean, that's a laugh every sometimes 8 or 10 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And that, if you can do that, I mean, that's Gaffigan, man. That's why Gaffigan's a multimillionaire.
Yeah.
His stuff is so tight and so well written that he has people laughing every 8, 9, 10, 11 seconds. Bam, 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 bam.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you want to do.
Yeah. So are you going to do this week?
I may add that in there, Kev. I'm not as confident in my, you know, my self-deprecating stuff.
Yeah. Okay.
And I may just throw that out.
Okay.
Or at least most of it. I mean, there's a couple really good laughs in there.
Mm-hmm.
So I would pare it down a lot. I would get rid of like the little big town song thing. I'd get rid of and really pare it down a lot. And then I'd add this Jesus stuff. And then, you know, Timmy's daddy's got a big pee-pee and Jonas is Percy.
Yeah.
To finish it.
That'd be great.
See, yeah, that'd
be really solid. Yeah.
Is that cool?
For sure.
All right.
Yeah. And like you could do the, I mean, you could do it either way. You keep the Timmy story first, Jonah story last, and then it doesn't matter how you put in the Jesus story or your relationship trouble story, because they're both, you could probably do your relationships first, your relationship stories first, and then say, you know what? I wasn't the only one that had relationship problems. Apparently Jesus was married. Boom, you're in.
Hmm. I like that. I like that. Or I like the idea of starting with the Timmy story,
mm-hmm.
then getting into Jesus, my Jesus chunk,
mm-hmm.
and then doing just a small piece, speaking of, you know, relationship. I have the problem, same problems myself. Okay.
Yeah. Like I said, you could flip flop either one of those.
And Kev, because I could be garbage literally for 4.5 minutes. And if I finish with Percy, I go out on a laugh.
Absolutely. But you won't be garbage for 4.5 minutes. You know, 4:25 maybe, but.
Kev, if one person laughs.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
That's all I care about. Okay. All right.
Get two in the audience and you just improved your chances.
There you go.
Yeah. No, dude, okay. It's good. It's good. And I really like the idea of paring back the relationship problems, because I thought that the way that you were presenting that in written form, you were too dark on yourself. You know,
like I beat myself up too much.
Yeah. Yeah. You beat yourself up too much. And like I was thinking about this the other day when I was mowing the other, the neighbor's lawn. You're the comedian and you're the hero. And if you're up there bashing yourself to the degree that you were, people aren't going to believe in that. You know, they're not going to think you're the hero. You're going to think, wow, why am I supporting this guy?
So you think I'm overcompensating?
I think so. Yeah. You know, I mean, self-deprecating is that it could be just one line, you know, it doesn't have to be a whole story. It could be just one line.
So I can take, you know, the very best good laughs of that right there.
Yeah, the Astros story is perfect. You know,
that's it.
Yeah, took you to see front row, took you front row for the World Series. I could have taken you. You could have seen the Astros shower afterwards. That's funny. And you're still going to leave me.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. All right. I like that.
So
I like that. What I was thinking of doing this week, I was going to go, you know, because I haven't been to one of these since 2019.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to go to like Rudyard's or, you know, and some of the different places that have an open mic, go in and just kind of like check and scope things out and then put up a game plan. And I think next week I'm going to hit 2-3 times.
Dude, it's like dipping your toe in cold water. You don't do that. You just jump in.
See, and I'm, yeah, Kev, I was just telling you that, but knowing me, it'd be like, okay, I got the itch. These guys suck.
Yeah.
I can bury these guys. I'm going on stage.
Yeah. If you're going to go, you're going to go to get on stage. You don't go to test the water. Because number one, what could happen? What you just said could happen. They suck so bad. You feel compelled to get up there. Okay. Then you've already gone there with the mindset that I might not get up there. So you're not really prepared. Or you could do what I would do, and you would go and you would hear something that's really funny, and you'd be like, I'm not as funny as that guy. I'm not going to get up tonight. And then you've paralyzed yourself. You're going to go and you're going to do it. You're going to go and you're going to get up there.
Here's another thing. Let me know what you're thinking.
Uh-huh.
I use a different name.
Okay.
Because the last time I did this, and still even to this day, and hell, I haven't even been on the air on the radio in almost 2 years.
Hmm?
Tim Tuttle. Second date update guy.
Okay.
I don't want to be, when I do this, second date update guy. Because then people will start thinking, instead of listening to what I'm doing, they're thinking about, oh yeah, second date update. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I'm thinking of going up as, tell me if you like this,
mm-hmm.
Jose Camarillo.
I figured that was the name you were going to go with. Yeah. I was getting ready to bring you up on stage, but yeah, Jose Camarillo. What a dork.
I should do that, shouldn't I?
No. Go up as Tut Timmel.
That's funny. Jim Juddle.
Yeah. Now be yourself, man. You know why? Because people, it's going to open doors for you, bro.
Yeah.
It will. You know? And once it ain't going to take them very long to get past, oh, I used to listen to this guy on the radio. Now I'm listening to him live. Oh my God, that's funny. He can never say that on the radio. It'll open doors for you, bro.
Okay.
Yeah, right. Do it. Don't overthink that.
I'll trust your judgment. Okay, that's what I'm going to do.
That's the only thing I'll trust for me, Kline.
That's all. Okay, this has been fun.
It's been a blast.
By the way, and we have to tell you this every single time, it is so important that when you go to a podcast forum, if you're on one right now, please download the episode. Yeah. We like to see downloads. And that really helps us too. And then do us a favor, subscribe to it and give us a rating. You know, we would love for you to give us a rating and of course, like and follow and all that stuff. That is so important for the continuous growth of this podcast. I mean, we want to do this for you once a week, every single week for the next 10 years, but we need, you know, some kind of support from you in order to do it. And we got to continue to be growing too. So tell your friends about us.
Yeah, Tim wants it for growth. I just need it for validation. I have low self-esteem, and I really need that. I need it. Okay.
You need this for a boost?
Yeah, I need it for a boost. Yeah.
You know, I was talking to somebody last week, and they said, you know, are you concerned, you know, that it doesn't mushroom and be? I'm like, I couldn't care less. I just like having the creative outlet. I don't care if one person listens.
Mm-hmm.
If just one person listens, and I know my daughter Audrey's going to listen. By the way, she's got her own podcast.
Does she?
Yeah, it's Hype Girl. She, you know, Miss Positive is once a week going to come out with 25 minutes. Kev, can I do this? Can you put this up right here? This is Audrey's podcast.
Yeah, I'm putting it up right now.
She just released the first episode and just cut the second episode. And Audrey is the most positive human being on planet Earth. And just to listen to her, I was so proud of her. I listened to her first 25-minute podcast, and I was so impressed with her.
What's the format? What is she doing?
She's your hype girl. She picks you up. She's, you know, positive vibes. You know, what Audrey's always been is just always the most positive person in the room, the person to make you feel good, to lift you up. And she's got ways and methods that she uses to stay positive. And I absolutely love it. It's really, really good stuff. I know there's a lot of people who like to listen to like self-help books.
Yeah.
Tony Robbins and all that stuff. 25 minutes of Audrey Tuttle will be pretty good too.
I can't wait to listen.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to listen. So
Also, keep in mind that we have merch available.
This stuff is sharp. Look, it's really cool looking.
Look at this little, what do they call this? This little mug thing right here. I mean, this is really.
Is that a tumbler?
I think it's a tumbler.
Okay. It's cool. Yeah. Looking.
Look how cool that thing is.
Yeah.
And look how that logo just sizzles.
It does. It does.
I absolutely love it. Only the highest quality merchandise. Please go to Tuttle and Kline Facebook, like our Facebook, and there's specific instructions on how you can order our high quality with the neat logo merchandise. That would be totally cool. Kev, what do you have coming up this week, buddy?
You know what, Tim? I'm hoping that you will listen to the episode this week of the Fuzzy Mike, because I did part of it for you.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So I'm talking with Ozzy's bass player. Okay. The guy who wrote Shout in the Dark. And he's got about a 5-minute story about his friendship with Jimmy Page, one of your all-time legendary heroes.
Kev, I saw you posted something on that.
Yeah.
And now I have regret that I didn't get a chance to talk to him.
It's all right.
Because he's got a Jimmy Page Led Zeppelin story.
Yeah, and it's stories that you've never heard before about Jimmy Page and Led Zeppelin. And I was like, oh, Tim's going to get goosebumps hearing this.
Does he verify the rumors about the song Black Dog?
No, he doesn't talk at all about Led Zeppelin's music. He talks about how secretive and shy the band was. It was very difficult to get pictures taken with them, but he talks about getting a phone call from Jimmy Page.
How cool is that?
Yeah, dude, your life would be made.
Real quick, you know the Black Dog story, right?
Wasn't it just a black dog hanging out by the studio?
They recorded the song.
Uh-huh.
You know, hey, mama said the way you move, gonna make you sweat, gonna make you groove. And they basically recorded that like out of nowhere, just like going back and forth. Robert would just sing some lyrics. I mean, it was like completely pulled out of the butt at the end of the session. And Jimmy would do the na 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 na. And they just, I mean, it's almost a complete 100% riff song.
Wow. It became one of their all-time legendary songs.
Lyrics and everything. And they get done recording it. And, you know, that was the last recording session. And Jimmy Page is walking out and he's got his guitars under his arm. He's heading out to his vehicle or whatever. And the producer comes out and says, you know, that last thing you did in there, I know you didn't intend for that to be an actual, you know, cut or whatever, but that is really good stuff. And Jimmy said, well, thank you, mate.
Yeah.
Or whatever, however Jimmy
paid. Of course. We were right there on the same page.
Okay. And he goes, well, we probably should put this on the record, you know, the Led Zeppelin 4 record. But we need a title. What should we call it? And he looks and he sees in the studio a black dog. And he just looks over and he goes, call it Black Dog. And then just leaves and goes to his car.
Nice.
Is that cool or what?
That's the origin of that story. I had no idea
there's no black dog mentioned in the song whatsoever.
No, that's why I always found it puzzling, the name of the song.
Yeah.
It's nothing about a black dog.
They needed a name really quick, and that's what he looked at.
Wow.
I mean, the song could have been called Half Eaten Cheeseburger.
Wouldn't have resonated as much with that title as Black Dog.
Can you see Robert Plant? All right, everybody, you wanted it. It's our big hit. Half-eaten cheeseburger.
Yeah.
All right. Anything else happening, Kev?
Let's see. Anything else happening? I don't think so.
Then let's go out on.
Well, what do you got coming up?
Huh?
What do you got coming up? Oh, by the way, if you do go do open mic, record it. Have somebody record it.
I'll record it.
Yeah, for sure. And we can play some of it.
Do you really want to do that?
Yeah. Dude, what you're doing right now, it's no different than training for a race, a marathon. You're putting in the hard work right now, okay? Getting up on stage, running the race, that's the celebration, man.
See, Kev, I love this too because, you know, we reached the pinnacle in our goal in radio.
Uh-huh.
You know, we were in top 10 market many years. You know, we were the morning show voices for the number one country music radio station in the United States of America. At the apex, we had 1.5 million people listening to Second Date Update. And this, right at what I'm doing right now, ground zero.
Yeah.
Like I'm nothing. And I have to work my way up.
It gets you back to those days of hungry.
I loved it.
Yeah, in radio when you're really, really hungry to make your mark.
I love being garbage again. It's fun.
Oh, you should switch roles with me. It's every day, man. It's every day.
Black dog. Call it black dog. I'm out of here, Kline. I got to bail.
That's it for this episode of the Tuttle and Kline Show. See you this Wednesday for an all-new episode. Also, you can catch Tuttle on TV. He is a handsome man. And you can get more Kline on his podcast, The Fuzzy Mike, with new episodes on Tuesday. Stay fuzzy, friends. And thanks for listening to the Tuttle and Kline Show. Yo. All right, take the yo out.